So Jamie, take it away. I'm excited about this.
Okay, thanks a lot. So this is basically just kind of a recap of the season, but a lot happened. So I'm mostly just going to talk about three avalanche cycles, because otherwise it would be too much. But I'm going to focus on an avalanche event that happened in February, the power line storm, and which was a very widespread avalanche cycle that closed all the highways in and out of Jackson for a period of time in early February. So anyhow, I'm not exactly sure how I'm going to do this, but we'll just get into it here. So I think this is a good quote from Liam: appreciating accomplishments leads to complacency. Appreciating mistakes leads to avoiding them. So I'm not going to stand up here and be like, it was all good, we kicked some ass, high fives, but you know, try and be real about what happened, what went right, and where things got away from us a little bit. So just to give you maybe some background about the avalanche problem affecting highways around Jackson Hole, and then a little bit about the toolbox we have for mitigation, and then recap these three avalanche cycles: December 15th, January 9th, and February 1st, or February 1st through the 10th, and December 15th of 2016. A little error there. So four avalanche corridors in and out of Jackson Hole right here. Teton Pass, which is the main one I think we're all familiar with probably. But then these river canyons, the Snake River Canyon from Hoback Junction down to Alpine. It was a pretty long stretch of highway with about 30 avalanche paths to impact the road. And then the Hoback Canyon, not as many avalanche paths, but they're pretty big, and some of them are pretty dangerous, and it's really quite cold down here, so the snowpack tends to be really weak and faceted. And then there's some paths just north and south of Jackson on US 89 that can hit the road. So, and all these kind of corridors have different character, different snowpacks, and so Teton Pass, you know, big avalanche paths, the Glory Bowl, Twin Slides are kind of the main avalanche paths that impact the highway. Starting zones are right at 10,000 feet and, you know, can produce really big, dangerous deep slab problems. And, but then there's also some smaller paths on the west side that aren't typically as big of a problem, but when they are, the paths aren't as big, but they're certainly pretty numerous. This is a place we call the Beaver Slides that we do hand control route on, and while they're small paths, they can put, I've seen 15 to 20 feet of snow in, you know, covering, I don't know, 500 feet of highway. And Teton Pass, we average 5,000 cars a day. So super busy highway. That's the average daily traffic. So a lot of people rely on that route to commute in to work, and so busy place. And then a lot of skier traffic, and so managing all those things. And then the Snake River Canyon, the paths are a lot smaller, but they're very numerous and pretty typical for it. This is Astoria, and these are all come back up later when I get into these avalanche cycles. This is a place we call Corner Slide. This is kind of the indicator path in the Snake River Canyon, so we know we're kind of rolling into an avalanche cycle when we see activity here at Corner Slide. It's kind of the first one to produce an avalanche. And then this is called the Gold Mine, so you can kind of see the problem. If you get one avalanche in the road, you're gonna have traffic underneath all this hazard. And the Snake River Canyon does about 10,000 cars a day on average. So busy place. This is Red Creek, really active place. Seen a plow truck get buried in an avalanche right here during a closure about 10 years ago. And then the Hoback River Canyon, all those paths in the Snake River Canyon are south facing. The Hoback's got kind of a mixture. This is the Cow and Calf of the Woods, super active avalanche path. And then Granite Creek, this is south facing, this is north facing. Hoback, or the Cow of the Woods, was in the road 10 times this winter. to varying degrees. It's a total pain in the ass and really hard to forecast for because there's no access to the starting zone. So you basically have pretty limited amount of information about what's going on there. The starting zone is 8,000 feet here. This is about, these are pretty small paths, although we're gonna have to update our atlas, turns out. And we had an avalanche initiate up here and hit the road this winter. So, Cal the Woods can put some big piles in the road. That's a wet slab from a few years ago. But even the small avalanche can be pretty problematic here, because any sort of small avalanche is going to make the highway. So, can you guys see these all right? Should we close the shades? We good?
We don't know how to close the shades.
Oh. Okay, never mind. And then there's some paths just right in Jackson that are, these are just north of town. We call this one Welcome to Jackson Hole, because this is the Welcome to Jackson Hole sign right here. And both of these were in the road in a pretty, size 3 this year. And these are mostly driven by wind events, big south winds. You can see how they're on the lee. These paths are in the lee, so these are scoured and then deposited here in the leeward side. And same with this one. And a lot of deer in these paths, so wildlife triggers. And I've never seen this one. I've seen this one in the ditch, and this one buried the road pretty good, about 100 feet of road, 10 to 15 feet deep. So the toolbox, we got a howitzer that we rarely shoot anymore. We're trying to phase out of artillery, and we've gone more to infrastructure and Gazex. We've got 4 Gazex exploders on Teton Pass, 3 in Glory Bowl, 1 in Twin Slides, propane and oxygen mixture, detonated remotely, and these things work great as long as you keep up with them, keep them maintained. But these are 20, well, 2 of them are about 20 years old, and we replaced the 2 oldest ones a few years ago. And we've got 2 of these avalanche guard towers with these blaster boxes on them that can put out a 4-kilogram shot out onto a slope, cast booster. And then we have 2 Obelix gas exploders in the Cow of the Woods. So that's how we've phased out of artillery down there. And this is hydrogen and oxygen. The Gazex exploders are about 2.8 cubic meters. This is about 0.8 cubic meters of gas, but that hydrogen makes it pretty hot. And so we've had those for a few years, and that's been a huge asset for us in the Hoback. As far as trying to keep up with that thing a little bit better, instead of, with our howitzer, we're mobile, so we gotta load it up, get the ammo, tow it into place, shovel off the firing bases, so it's a real time-consuming and manpower-intensive operation. And we do helicopter bombing as needed, but mostly, I think, what I'm gonna talk about here is, road closure is your friend, and you can bomb it all you want, but really, when you get into these big cycles, you just got to be closed. So, especially when you have as many avalanche paths as we have. So, we had a really snowy winter. We had 550 inches of snow, I think, last total. We had a million miles of wind. The wind just never stopped. We had very little storm events without just extreme southwest and west winds. And then we had everything from minus 30 degrees Fahrenheit in early January to a lot of rain events to, with plus 50 degree temperatures. And we were doing huge temperature swings within, 7 and 10 days. So rain event and then turn super cold. And so, that kind of played into having a lot of these repeat avalanches. And then the atmospheric river, which we got pounded by the atmospheric river a few times. So that was the main driver in a couple of these avalanche cycles. I think California ended up having 8 atmospheric river events, and we had 3 strong ones, I'd say. And it's interesting, if you don't know the atmospheric river, it's like the Pineapple Express, right? So it's typically the jet stream tapping into the subtropical moisture, pulling it all the way up from the tropics and the Pacific. And it truly is a river of moisture, water vapor, and coming on shore and just letting loose. So I was doing some research, and pretty much you could equate it to the amount of the water volume equates to basically the Mississippi River at the mouth, which is about like 700,000 CFS or something like that. So truly is the atmospheric river of water. And that drove a lot of like rain events for us to like 9,000 feet with really strong west, southwest winds. And so wind-driven rain and rain on cold snow is guaranteed avalanches pretty much every time. And that's what we had. So it all started, we did have record precip in October, and that was mostly rain in the valleys, but there was snow up high. But then November dried out, and a lot of that, all that low elevation snow melted, and except for high north through east, it hung in there. And so other than that, it was just bare ground. And then December 1st, we rolled into a pretty consistent snowfall. So we didn't have like widespread faceted snowpack or anything like that. It was just like that high north through northeast. And we rolled into pretty consistent snowfall in December. And then on December 15th, we had a skier triggered avalanche onto an open highway on Teton Pass at Twin Slides at about 4:45. At night, 4:50, so right at dark, and it took a Jeep off the road, and so it was right at rush hour. It was quite chaotic, but it took this Jeep off the road about 50 feet, blew the windows out of it, filled the cab with snow. The driver was okay, he's pretty banged up, but no serious injuries. The Jeep was pretty trashed. So I'm just gonna go through my notes a little bit because that's what I gotta do. So let's see. I do know, like, this was December 15th this morning, and it was like 5 in the morning. There was like 2 inches of new snow. All right, so we're just rolling into the storm cycle. The avalanche danger was rated at high for the day, and by 5 o'clock that night, we were at 10 inches. A lot of wind, blizzard conditions, really a poor day to be skiing. Steep terrain, for sure. Storm total was 16 inches with 1.57 inches of water. For the 24-hour period, was southwest winds, averaging 28, gusting to 55, with 668 total miles of wind. We had rained at the 7,000 feet. It was a warming snowpack. It was a warm front, basically. So we were warming, so the densities were increasing through the accumulation. We did have faceted snow high north through east, but this was a south-facing slope, and I would say the snowpack was strong as far as like the old snow. We had planned a closure for the 16th at 3 a.m., on the 15th, we were on the pass in the morning, but we got, one of the problems we had all winter was because the canyons were so active with avalanches, we got stretched super thin. I'm an avalanche technician, and there's one other avalanche technician, and then we have a 13-man crew that works road maintenance, and we just got stretched super thin because it was just widespread avalanche activity, so trying to run around, and that's kind of what happened to us on the 15th. We ended up in the Hoback Canyon for most of the day because of the cycle. There was a natural avalanche cycle occurring down there. So we were down there doing control work and doing cleanup, and we didn't get back to the pass until 4:30. And so we're on the hill. It was snowing, the wind was blowing. Certainly it was a high danger day. And we drove up and over, and this slide just missed us. So then we turned around, and we were the second ones on scene with some sheriff's deputies, and we initiated the rescue operation because we weren't sure skier triggered or you know, we just weren't sure. So that all went down, and a lot of people in the starting zone. Okay, not skiing like the gut of twin slides, but this thing crossloads, and so quite easy to trigger remotely from a place someone might think is the shoulder of the slide, but it's actually the starting zone. So from what we can tell from accounts, there's maybe 6 to 8 people in that terrain at 4:30 at night on a high danger day. So it's dark. Check the debris, and then it's rush hour, so cars everywhere. So we got everybody turned around and out of there. And proceeded to do the rescue operation. We ended up clearing the debris with a dog from the Jackson Hole Mountain Resort, and then the pass remained closed for the night. But control work on the other paths, Glory Bowl, produced really no results, so it was pretty kind of localized to this spot. Yeah, go ahead.
Could you see the Jeep when you guys got out?
Yeah, you could see it. I don't know if you can tell here, but this is how it was in the snow here. It was up on its side. It was spun around. He was westbound. It ended up being pointed eastbound when it came to rest about 50 feet off the road. So, you know, the twin slides, I mean, it was a dry snow slide. It was moving fast, you know, blew the windows out. And he had no passenger, which was like a really, really good thing, you know. So he was able to climb out of the window, but the cab was pretty filled with snow. But yeah, you could see the Jeep. And we were able to get a hold of him on the phone and ask him if there were any cars in front of him or behind him or what. It was pretty, the debris was narrow, but it was 20 feet deep. Yeah, it was at least 20 feet deep. And so it was maxing out our probes in the road depth, in the road bed. And we were able to interview a lot of the skiers that were in that terrain, came down, so we were interviewing them, trying to figure out if there were skiers in it, no beacon signals, ran a probe line with the people we had, and then cleared it with the dog. And then pass remained closed. That's that. Any questions about that? That was kind of...
How do you assess the hang fire from down there?
Twin Slides is a really small starting zone. It was super obvious to us that thing was done. Yeah. If it had been Glory Bowl, we would have had a more conservative approach. I think, and we would have probably just gotten out there and checked it with a beacon, and if there was no signal, we would have backed off and maybe gotten some more people in place to back us up, I guess. And we did have, we did activate search and rescue and had them kind of headed towards us to maybe back us up, or in case there was a secondary slide with all the traffic and everything else, given that we weren't sure if it was skier trigger, we weren't sure if it was a natural. At the time, so we did have those resources in play. But yeah, had it been Glory Bowl, where that thing can slide multiple times, 50-acre starting zone, certainly a more conservative approach, especially in the dark and with the conditions the way they were. But this is a small starting zone, so we were very, very confident it was good to go. Yeah.
What came of the skier that triggered it? Were they going to get raped through the media?
Well, there was the sheriff's office pursued an investigation and interviewed the people that were on scene and were talking about criminal charges. But there, without hard evidence, you know, someone saying, hey, I saw that guy ski in there, trigger that slide, or without someone admitting to it, there wasn't enough evidence to press charges. They were going to pursue a criminal endangerment charge, I believe. So from my perspective, I was really disappointed that there were that many people in that terrain at that time of day. And I was glad the sheriff's office did an investigation, just did the due diligence, and that word got out to the community a little bit, you know. And the guys that were up there, it wasn't the guy who just took the level one, who just moved to town. It was a lot of longtime Jackson locals who ski a lot and know better. But go ahead.
Oh yeah, I was just gonna ask. So I mean, if obviously people are skiing these or they're stacking people in the start zones during a high avalanche danger day, and you guys are making decisions about closing the road and things like that, do you basically just have to assume that people are going to be center punching these lines at any time, and so you have?
We definitely account for that in our decision making process. Yeah, we're not just forecasting for natural avalanche cycles on Teton Pass, you know. In hindsight, you know, certainly I would have done a daytime closure, but you know, I thought our snowpack could handle an inch of water. I thought, you know, certainly the densities were changing, and had we not gotten pulled down to the Hoback, maybe we would have made that call, but we got stretched pretty thin. We didn't get back up there. And daytime closures are a pretty hard thing to do. I mean, you just got to close. You can't do control work because you got skiers in the terrain you can't account for. So daytime closures are really hard unless you plan way ahead, you know, and keep people from parking and all those things. So certainly this thing got away from us a little bit. In hindsight, a daytime closure would have been the thing to do, but you know, you got to be objective and that's what we do. We be objective and we make decisions based on, you know, based on the data we have. And so that's what happened. So then a month later, January 9th, consult my notes again. I don't have any good pictures from January 9th. It's mostly like fuzzy piles of snow and dark and snowy. So, but this was an atmospheric river event on January 9th that rained to 8,500 feet, lots of wind, lots of snow. So just from my notes here, significant winter storm. January 8th through the 11th, stored totals were 42 inches anew with 4.18 inches of water and 3,200 miles of wind. So with warm temps, strong winds, extreme amounts of snow, very unstable avalanche conditions. So this was interesting. And then in early January, it was like 30 below. So we had a pretty deep snowpack, so it could kind of handle the cold up high, but the canyons, not so much, you know, thinner snowpack. So we had some faceted snow. And on Sunday, January 8th, we knew the Cow of the Woods was going to be ready to go. It's cold. It's north facing. I swear it snowed an inch, and that thing put 10 feet of snow on the road. So, I don't know. That's the other thing I wanted to say is, like, the highway thing's really hard. I mean, the highway doesn't sleep, you know. It doesn't run from 9 to 4. It runs 24 hours a day. And then they kind of built these roads in stupid places. So, there you go. It snowed like 2/10 of an inch of water, and the Cow of the Woods put 10 to 14 inches of snow on the highway. That was Sunday night. And then we knew that, let's see, what happened? We closed the pass on Monday morning, and we were in at 9 and 10 at night, you know, dealing with the Hoback. And we came back in at 1 in the morning, and the landscape had changed, like, in a few hours. So we closed everything. It was raining heavily in the Snake River Canyon. It was the slickest road I've ever seen. Snow floor with rain on it, turned ice. So we had to chain up all our equipment, and we just closed the snake, closed the hoback, closed the pass. And then, and like, that's like, road closure is your friend. Like, we have no control of this situation right now. We have no idea what's going on. Everything's closed, and then triage, let's work through this and get them open in some sort of systematic way. And so that's what we did. We closed all the roads. It was raining in the Snake River Canyon. It was snowing super hard in the hoback and on the pass. And so we just like, Teton Pass is closed. We'll get to that when we can get to it. And then we went down the hoback and to do control work. And by the time we got there, the cow had slid again. And it was in the road, 15 feet deep, 75 feet wide. So we cleaned, and then so we did control work. We got another slide out of the Caffa Woods, which is adjacent. And we did clean up, which we finished around 5 a.m. And then we just left it closed for a couple hours. And then down the Snake River Canyon, where there'd been several naturals, eight natural avalanches in the Snake River Canyon during the road closure with the heavy rain. So we're down there with the rotary, and we don't do any control work in the Snake River Canyon. There's just too many paths, too many starting zones. It's just not. It could be a useful tool for like testing stability for trying to decide when to reopen, but as far as going down there and blasting everything out onto the highway, probably not a real efficient or effective way to deal with that problem. So. But what we do, which is a little cowboy sometimes, is we'll try and trigger avalanches with the rotary, which works pretty good, actually. Got to get a little close, but it's a big machine. But anyhow, so we're down there, and we're, just got to check my notes again, sorry. So eight naturals in the row. We did trigger one with the rotary at corner slide. Everything was chained up. We got everything cleaned up, and we reopened the snake about 8 a.m. Figured everything had slid. It was cooling, so we did reopen that. And then at 9 a.m. we got up on the pass. We had to basically plow our way up there, and we triggered a slide of Glory Bowl 20 feet deep. And then we went up to the top, and we rolled up to the top with the rotary, big road cut right there at Twin Slides, and we triggered that with the rotary that was put 4 to 5 feet in the road, and it propagated for 1,000 feet. And then sympathetically brought down Twin Slides. So pretty touchy. Then we worked through all that debris. The pass was a pretty good mess, pretty much blown in. And we did some hand charging in some other places. We just left it closed for the night. And then at 7 p.m. that night, we had a natural avalanche in the hoback from a path I'd never seen in the road. Put 10 feet of debris in the highway, and a vehicle drove into it, became stuck. So we left it closed. And then Tuesday on the 10th, we controlled on the pass, no results. Reopened the hoback at 5:30. Opened the pass at 6:30 a.m. Back down in the hoback at 4:30. Control work, small avalanches, size ones. Then the next day, so this is Wednesday, January 11th, we closed the pass at 3 a.m. for avalanche control, triggered a large slide at Twin Slides, put 12 feet of snow on the road. Again. Back down to the hoback, no results. And then 1:30 in the afternoon, we had a natural avalanche at the Astoria in the Snake River Canyon, put 12 feet of debris, and that's an avalanche hitting the road at the hoback. Somewhere in there, I have no idea. And then January 11th, this boom truck got hit by an avalanche at Astoria, which is outside of our road close gates. And that's the other thing I should mention about the hoback, there's no road close gates. Super handy, right? And so yeah, this natural avalanche at Astoria. I was on the pass all day, so I didn't even, wasn't sure what was going on here. Got down there, but this boom truck guy, it was a big avalanche across both lanes, 10 feet deep. We're lucky it was a big truck, a little bit of damage to it. Outside of our road glows gates, it was warm. It wasn't really precipping, but it was just that warm, low sky. So we've had a very low risk tolerance, so we just closed the road and we knew it was going to cool off and we waited for it to cool off. So it cooled off and we opened the canyon at 7, and that kind of was the end of that cycle. So, and I think I wrote in my notes that it was a exceptional event, probably on the rare side, but then it happened again a month later. So, so we got some nice weather, and we had shot all the shots in our Obelix, which we have, the way we're configured, we can get 9 out of it. We'll probably switch some things around and be able to get like 20 next year. So we had to resupply all that. So we did that in that break in the wither. And we certainly had some more avalanche cycles and some more control work, but I'm not gonna get into that. So, and then February. February was pretty exciting. And it started on February 1st with a natural avalanche just north of town at a path that I've only seen it in the ditch, but it buried the road like a size three hard slabs. Big south wind event. Warmish temps, some snow, but mostly big wind, a lot of snow to transport, and big hard slab avalanche buried the road here pretty good, about 1 in the morning. And these paths, we've never controlled them. And so we got it cleaned up, we got it open about daylight, and then I was looking and it was pretty obvious that there was some hazard lingering at the Welcome to Jackson Hole. And so I had to do some quick research. It's private land, it turns out. Contacted the landowner, asked him if we could go up there and do avalanche control. And he was a little confused, but also quite excited. So, send me a picture, that sounds awesome. And so that's what we did. We went up there and we brought down this slide, hard slab, pretty good size 3, and pretty good story. We got up there and snow surface is super firm, you know, this shot could roll, we better be heads up. So what do? We roll down there and my partner is like, it's gonna stick, I'll just throw it super high. It bounced and started rolling, and luckily it caught on a bush. So that was exciting. So the next shot, we just put it right on the edge of the slab. And yeah, a lot of deer in these paths. Man, really hard winter on the wildlife. But this thing pounded the road pretty good. It's about 7,500 feet wide. 10 feet deep, 10 to 12 feet deep. So that's like right in town. Yeah. Just on the edge of town.
Did you harvest any muleys out of the deal?
No. I've seen wildlife triggered slides on all those paths, and a lot of paths in town, and yeah, they start to melt out and the hooves start to appear. So, and we've had deer triggered avalanches that have hit the road, hit cars, and one that was before my time that put a deer through a back window of a car. So does happen. So I got to consult my notes again. So that's kind of that was the start of February, and then we did have some avalanches and some control work for that first week, but really the power line event starts on February 7th. And this is kind of a, this is a good cycle, and this is a really, we got stretched to our limit about, of managing it. You know, we're risk managers, and so we really got, tasked with a pretty good one here. And so there's a lot of things that, a lot of factors that came into play. So I'll just gonna go through my notes the best I can here and spell it out for you. So Tuesday, February 7th, we closed the pass at 3 a.m. and it wouldn't reopen until February 11th. Twin slides, 6 feet deep across 30 feet of highway, size 3. Some results in the Glory Bowl, but they didn't make the highway. And then the pass was pretty well blown in, so we left it closed so we could do cleanup operations and get the road wide enough to open to traffic. And while we did that, and this is an atmospheric river event, and it was kind of, you know, that those things shift around, so we, so a lot of things happened. We did clean up at the top, we got over the other side, and the weather would improved quite a bit, and we had a rotary breakdown right in the middle of the road. And in hindsight, it was probably a good thing, because we were, right at that moment, we could have opened the highway. But not with the rotary stuck in the middle of the road. So we were working on getting some parts and getting that thing up and running. We had two machines up there working. And we knew it was gonna be a big week, so we put out a call for help, and we got two extra guys to come up from other part of the state, which is a really good move. And so we were doing our thing, running around, checking conditions and all over the places, and the pass was still closed, and I was like, well, hey, let's go up there and do some control work at the beaver slides and just test stability, you know, and see what happens. So we went up to the beaver slides, and it had started to snow again. The densities were coming up. The temperatures were warming. The forecast was for the winds to crank out of the west. And so we went to the beaver slides, and we put some shots out, and we were triggering these soft slabs at the interface that were propagating and running fast and far. And this one, and so it put 12 feet of snow on the road. And with that result, and given the forecast, we're like, let's just leave it closed. It's not worth it. And I'm really glad we did, because on the 7th, that night, we did the beaver slides, but then when we left it closed, and it was like, okay, we're out of here. Rotary's stuck. Let's just leave it. We'll fix it later. We need to leave. So we went to leave, and we got over to milepost 7, which is just a big road cut mostly, but it's big, and it came out natural, and we were stuck actually on the pass. We had to dig our way out. And that was pretty big. It's 6 to 8 feet deep across 150 feet of highway. And, okay. So then that night, a huge wind event destroyed 17 power poles, going out to Teton Village, just bent them all over just like this, right in a row. Boom, 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 these big metal poles that have been there for 50 years. So no power at the Teton Village, Jackson Hole Mountain Resort, shut down. And then state of emergency declared for Teton Village. So that whole state of emergency thing really complicated my whole scene quite a bit, because the governor got involved, Homeland Security got involved, you know, a lot of money on the line at Teton Village, and Lower Valley Energy is trying to get equipment into the on scene, generators, all kinds of stuff. So it really changed the, I don't know, maybe the expectation. There's really very little tolerance for road closures in Jackson, even though I don't care. But you know, when the governor is calling, wondering what's going on, this will come into play later. We'll come back to this. So pass remained closed overnight. We go back up there on the 8th. We get, what'd we do? Oh, I gotta look at my notes again, sorry. Go back up on the pass. Okay, so all these naturals happen on the west side. This is west of the Beaver Slides. I've seen there were 7 of these in the road, full of trees, trees with root balls. Not big trees, but maybe 6 to 8 inches in diameter. And 7 of them in the road. 2 of them I've seen before. So that huge wind event, and then it was kind of wind-driven rain that the debris seemed like it was on the wet side to me. But, you know, on that January 9th event, too, we had rained 8,500 feet, turned cold afterwards. That snow surface from January 9th held that heat a little bit. You know, the cold air moved in, boom, sliding surface with facets on it, like, just like that. A month later, we roll into another cycle, and this happened. So anyhow, road was closed. These things was full of trees, so the rotary's not that useful. So we were digging our way through these. A lot of highway covered, slow going, and we definitely got to a point where we could have opened the highway. It was like 5 o'clock at night. People were calling, when's the road gonna open? And we, given the forecast, which was for a big rain event and a lot of more wind and snow, and my tolerance for risk being what it was, we got to the last pile and we punched a hole in it and we checked the rest of the road and it was clear. And then we went back to that pile and we dropped a load of snow in the hole to make sure nobody could get through, and we left. And I was glad we did. Okay, so, and then February 9th, we knew the place was gonna come unglued, all right? The forecast was for west winds at some ridiculous amount, you know, 50 knots, rained 8,500 feet, no freeze. We had a lot of snow on the ground, the most snow I've seen at low elevations in 15 years of doing the highway thing. And we knew it was gonna happen. We put out a press release on the 8th. Hey, if you don't have to travel, don't, you know, stay home. Contacted all our higher ups in our district office, told them that there was gonna be road closures, they were gonna be prolonged, and we didn't know what was gonna happen, and to be aware. And I don't know, I think our, a lot of what we do is kind of a big mystery in the highway department, right? The highway department's this big operation, this big state agency, and we're 2 guys that do avalanche stuff in this little corner of the state. And so the details of how we're good at what we do, they recognize that, but the details of how we do it are lost on them, which is fine, until they start telling me how to do my job. So on the 9th, we knew it was gonna happen. We came in at 2 in the morning and we were just hanging out waiting. It was raining. And corner slide is the indicator path. We were like, okay, corner slide. We see action there, we're gonna close it. And I thought the road would hang in there a little longer, but at 5 a.m. we had a natural at corner slide. Not very big, but that was it, closed the road. We went down there, we cleaned up that pile. We were just in the canyon. It was raining, and I will be the first to admit the wet slab, wet snow, rain on snow, not really my, we don't see a lot of it. You know, we deal with dry snow avalanches for the most part. So and I think the thing I learned from this whole cycle is just you gotta be patient with the wet snow, you know, you gotta be patient. And so again, we got the road cleaned up and Teton Pass is closed. Now Snake River Canyon's closed. Well, you're not getting your breakfast burrito in Jackson if all those roads are closed. So it was like 10 in the morning and it's raining hard. we're going and digging holes in the snow, and we're seeing a barrier where the water's pooling, and maybe the starts of some drainage channels. But we're definitely at a point where we could open this road, but we're like, okay, we gotta wait. Let's wait till noon. And so then we see another avalanche at Corner Slide, and actually it was just this little pocket right here. And then another, so we'd see two more wet slide avalanches, and we're kind of like, I think it's time to get out of here. And so Brian's in the rotary, and he triggers this, which is not a big slope, but it's quite long, and it's a wet slab that's propagating. And I go up and I look at the crown, the water's pooling, the water's pouring out of the crown face. I'm like, well, this is bad, and we're out of here. And so, and that was it, we left. Everybody's out of this canyon, it's not safe, we're not working in here, we're out of here. So that's what we did. And, which was the right call. So, you know, doing things how we're supposed to be doing them. And the whole time, the Hoback Canyon had been snowing, which was awesome. But that turned to rain in the afternoon. So we go to the Hoback, and the rain lines creeped all the way up the canyon, so it's raining at the Cow of the Woods. We do control work, size ones, no big deal. And we got all the equipment with us. We got a loader, we got a rotary. We go to leave the canyon, and this natural happens in a place no one's ever seen one. This is at Camp Creek. This is not even in the canyon. And wet slab, natural, propagated along this ridgeline here. Slid to the ground, full of rocks. And the debris was like blue. It's like a glacier. And so it took us hours to dig our way through this thing. Probably covered, I don't know, 300 feet of highway in the neighborhood of 10 feet deep. And so it took us hours to dig our way through this, and we've been at it for about 18 hours now. Been going. And after a long week too. So, and we have a little meeting. We're like, there's no way this canyon makes the night. It's raining. And it's gonna keep raining hard. And so we closed the Hoback. And then I got a call from my boss in Rock Springs, and he said, you can't close the road. And we had a bit of a discussion, let's call it. you know, the pressure, the Homeland Security wanted to bring all these generators through for Teton Village, and they wanted to get all this other equipment through to Teton Village. And I'm trying not to throw anybody under the bus. I explained my case, and I was pissed. I was super pissed. And I basically told them that they could come clean up the piles in the middle of the night, and that they were putting lives at risk, and that they should lawyer up. So, and it happened. So at 9 o'clock that night, we had a natural avalanche at the Granite, and it was big. It was big. It had trees in it. It came from somewhere in here. It put about 15 feet of snow in the road, had trees in it, and now it's the only road that's open. There's traffic backed up. Generators are on the wrong side of the pile. And so no sleep for me. Go down there, and we're digging out this pile, and this is not safe. This is not safe situation. These things are stacked up here, you know, like boom, path, 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 path. So, and all this traffic stopped underneath it. So we kind of get, and a lot of tractor trailers too. You just can't turn them around. You can't make them back up. You can't. So we punch a hole in this pile. We clear the traffic. We're on our way back, Cow of the Woods in the road, 15 feet deep. And then I had a bit of a meltdown. And this is at like 2 in the morning. Let's see. So yeah, Granite in the road, D3, lots of trees. Cow of the woods, D3, lots of trees. That was about midnight. And then we're digging our way out of the canyon again. And I go back to the office. Everything's closed. Take a 45-minute nap on the floor. And then we head down the Snake River Canyon. And it's tapered off. It's not raining so hard now. But there's pretty much everything slid in the Snake to varying degrees. But there's I think there was like 22 avalanches in the highway in the Snake. One laners, two laners, some of them full of trees. Nothing like huge, but 5 to 6, 7 to 8 feet deep. Everything slid. Great. Clean it up, open it. Boom. Get that thing open at about 10 a.m. We go down the Hoback, and while we were gone, pretty big, kind of wet loose, maybe wet, comes from way up high, triggers a wet slab, and all this wet debris is just gouging the landscape, you know, kind of like that Bridger Bowl event from April or March or whenever that was, just gouging the landscape, and huge pile of snow in the road right here. So, pretty scary, you know, dodged a bullet there with having traffic in that area stopped, you know. That thing would have just pushed those cars right in the river, no doubt. So we do clean up down there. We get to a point where we can open the Hoback. It's noon, it's not raining. The forecast isn't great, but it's not raining. And you know, they want the road open, so we open it. And so we go back to Teton Pass. We haven't been up there for 2 days. Thank God it wasn't open. We would have been stretched way too thin. So we go up there. I'm like, we're not going to go underneath. We're not going to go beyond Glory Bowl. We're just going to go there and shoot it and see what we get so we know what we have for cleanup. So we shoot it. And rain line's about 9,000 feet. And we trigger dry snow avalanches, soft slabs. Two big ones. And they come down, they hit the road, dry snow avalanche, powder cloud, and then powder clears. Oh, pretty good slide. And then here comes the wet snow. So it hit the rain line, entrained all the wet snow, and then here comes the wet, and it just buries the road. So we do this twice, and we end up with about 30 feet of snow across 200 feet of highway. 25, 30 feet deep, I don't know. Huge pile. And it's some trees, but this is me. I'm standing on top of the pile looking down at the cars here. So just try and give you a sense of perspective. All right, well, this is closed for a while. So we make the calls, we get some equipment headed this way, and we leave. And then it starts, we drive back into town, it is pouring rain. I'm freaking out about the Hoback, and it happens. Another slide at Granite, right here, big. Actually, you can see this is it. This is the boundaries of it right here. 20 feet deep, full of trees. Road's closed again. So back down there, we clean it up. We're looking at the weather. It starts snowing. We're like, thank God, it's snowing. So temperatures are cooling off, and we get to a point. Well, we left it as, okay, temperature's cool, it starts to snow, we're not going to open it until we have some sort of change in the weather. And that's what happened. We cooled off. All right, we're going to open. We opened. We had been down there. I should point this out. In the morning, we can't shoot the howitzer down here. There's a power line that runs right through the middle of this thing. We don't have an avalancher. Couldn't fly a helicopter. So we're down there at the toes of these slopes. We got some other test slopes, but we tried some of these too, putting like 15 pounders on a big stick, trying to test stability. Just not the most effective. And the wet snow thing, you know, if you guys do control work, it's it's touchy. You got to have big shots. You got to have perfect timing. It's just not. So we use that as a, you know, we had a plan when we went down and we're going to go down there and see, well, if these things slid, well, and we don't get any results with some of this control work, we'll open. We went down there, that stuff didn't slide. We did some control work, no results, and we didn't really stick to our plan, so we got rushed there. So we should have, you know, that patience, conservative approach. So then on February 11th, we punched a hole through that thing, and we got back open about 4 in the afternoon, 3 in the afternoon. And then sun came out, and that was the end of the cycle. And that might have been the last avalanche we had for the season. Can't remember. But, so season summary, February 1st through the 10th, 40 avalanches in the highway. For the season, 68 in the highway. Record precip and water for February. The state of emergency and the political pressure, you know, maybe that operating kind of under the radar like we are, is the advantages of that is that, you know, I kind of like it that nobody's meddling. Or I used to like it that nobody messed with us and they just let us do our thing. You know, I think we need to educate our supervisors, you know, they need to know about this. I don't think they quite understand how serious it can be. So, strong snowpack, it's not like we had widespread faceted snowpack. So certainly this was mostly, we didn't really see any avalanches into old snow. I guess a little bit in the canyons, but mostly interface. I would say that was majority of the storm, you know. Some things I'm proud of, zero misfires with the Gazex. We shot it 52 times and the Oval X 13 times because those things, you know, if you're really good at maintaining them and keeping up with that stuff, you can, making sure they work, it's critical. And then we shot zero howitzer rounds, and in hindsight, that's where we want to be because that's what we're phasing out of the howitzer. I want to get out of it. I want to keep it for one more season. So, yeah.
Is there any debrief with your bosses and governor and whatnot post-event?
Yeah, there was. It wasn't, in my mind, it wasn't what I wanted, so I'm going to pursue that some more. But I think the thing for them to remember is we have avalanches in the highways every year. You know, this isn't, I mean, certainly this was pretty exceptional, but to have, like, we had, I don't know, at least 5 rain events, significant rain events for the season. Maybe that's the new norm, you know, and I think that we should be really heads up with that. And, you know, it's not something I'm real comfortable with, the wet slab, the wet snow, the rain on snow. And so the conservative approach, and I don't know, I told them that we need to just close these roads and be patient. And if that's not going to work for them, then we're going to have to get an avalancher or something, you know, to not so much for control work, but maybe to test stability for the trying to get back open. Or I don't know, you know, so.
It'd be interesting if you were to give this talk in the Capitol with some senior people.
Yeah.
Give this talk so that, like, oh, you know.
Well, that's what we're talking about doing is taking this to the Highway Commission, and that's what my district boss wants to do. Yeah.
When was the last wet slab cycle?
I've never seen a wet slab cycle in Jackson. I've seen wet loose cycles, but I have not seen wet slab cycle. So, yeah. And, you know, when that stuff starts propagating, I mean, yikes, time to leave.
86, they had a bunch of wet slabs there, huh?
Morgan might know better, but I know that head walls thing was like the same.
I was just thinking about the 85, 86 year. And that year we had a big wet slide cycle. Tommy was killed.
Rain on cold snow.
And that was another 10 day or maybe more, and almost at the same time.
Big atmospheric river.
Started around the 10th to the 20th of February.
Well, and that head wall slide, same thing, started dry and then entrained all the wet.
Right after Tom's accident, but then it was shot.
Yeah, so.
But I was also thinking about the real pressure put on you with the highway during this storm. And it might have, a lot of it, I'm thinking, see if you agree, came from, you know, the power being out at Teton Village.
Oh, yeah.
And
no, that changed everything.
Power. And the pressure was really on because they were losing so much money every day. You know, because they had to evacuate everybody out of there and shut everything down for like Wednesday until power came on Sunday afternoon.
Yep.
That was really big.
All that power, not getting skied.
Yeah, they
did. Yeah.
Well, I mean, we had our hands full just trying to keep the upper part of the mountain from getting so, you know, heavily loaded that would knock out the restaurant and everything else. And running on a diesel generator, the tram, and no power and no water, and it was a mess. And the power lines were down, so it was dangerous. There was lines all over the road, and out there, and they let a little bit of traffic through. Trying to get the people out of there, back to town. You had pressure.
Yeah, the state of declaration of emergency really changed. And then the buildings were collapsing. The Sears building collapsed. The roof fell in. So
Togedy was the only road open.
Togedy was the only way in and out. So just in summary here, you know, the political pressure thing that's a hard one to deal with and to swallow, you know. You know, those guys don't know anything about avalanches. This is why they hire me. So we got to educate them. We got to make them aware of what we do and kind of what the hazard is. And then the atmospheric river and the warm front. I used to say, you know, hey, heads up with the cold front for natural avalanche cycles, right? The cold front, you got usually when the cold front passes, you got peak wind gusts, you got peak winds, peak precip rates. But now I'm like, God, the warm front. Oh my God, that thing. You know, when the densities are going up, and you have the wind, and certainly the atmospheric river is a heads up thing in my forecasting. Whenever I see it, kind of setting up. And road closure is your friend. You know, explosives are great, but you know, where do you start and stop with that? You know, you just got to be. And then these situations, you know. My crew comes first, and I'm not putting people at risk. I just assume be closed and let Mother Nature do her thing. And that's going to be my approach from here on out. And it's always been my approach, but I've certainly, with the warming climate and the rain events and all those things, I think the conservative approach is a good one. And keeping people out of harm's way is the most important thing.
Do you guys have any road damage with those bigger events?
No. Except, well, like, just we had so much snow, like, all the signs are broken, and, like, you know, all our... We had a sand shed that we store sand in. It collapsed. So that kind of damage. But the road bed surface is fine. Except for now we're having landslides, so... Yeah, the highway gig, I wouldn't recommend it. My mentor should have steered me some other direction, Carl. You know, I don't know that I need more staffing for forecasting. I need more operators. I need more equipment operators. I need more guys, you know. And certainly we did get stretched thin. We could have employed, you know, more avalanche guys because of the canyon problems. But really what we need is more operators right now, if I had to choose more positions. So.
We lost one snowmobiler during that event.
Yeah.
West of Elkhorn.
Well, nobody could go anywhere, so I think that's why.
Down there.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah, it probably would have been some, who knows how many avalanches happened, that we couldn't see because nobody was out and about, but yeah, no.
Your operator don't have avalanche backups?
No, well, we do in-house training. Everyone wears a beacon. We promote situational awareness type of thing. We produce a in-house avalanche forecast that's different from the backcountry forecast, just because at the different levels we have different concerns, like when you need to wear your beacon, when you need, like, so we're just promoting situational awareness and getting those guys to be, you know, if they're seeing events, we need them talking to us and letting us know what's going on. So we do in-house training. Some of them been to the National Avalanche School, phase one, or whatever it is. Yeah. Any other questions?
Do you guys get in trouble when things, like cars crashing into avalanches, or avalanches crashing into cars, or...
From a liability perspective?
Avalanches hit the road that's open and stuff like that?
I believe we're pretty well protected from those things, unless there's some sort of gross negligence. But I had a lawyer call me wanting some more information. But I think we're pretty well protected. I don't know the details of that, but you know, as far as I know, I haven't been sued yet. All right.
All right. Thanks, Jamie. All right, Austin.